We want to say a huge good morning to all of our virtual members of Columbine United Church. It is so good to have you with us. You are an important part of this congregation. You're an important part of spreading the good news of God's love all around the world. So we are grateful that you are here today watching this on YouTube. However, again, we want you to do more than just watch this. We want this message to change you and to change somebody else. So copy the URL and put it on your Facebook page. Or if you're listening to the sermon and you know, boy, I know someone who really needs to hear this message, then send it to them. Keep on taking the good news of Columbine United Church, but not really Columbine United Church, God's love around the world. Thank you for joining us. It's great to have you here today. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel according to Matthew, the fourth chapter, verses 18 through 22. This is where Jesus calls the disciples. Listen for God's word. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat, and their father followed him. And here ends the reading. May God bless these words as we now seek to apply them to our lives. The Big Bang reality, parallel universes, parallel lives. All right, there's a fun thing about this sermon. You know, the keynote that I put together for the sermon, I spent almost as much time on the keynote as I do writing the sermon, because the keynote is its own sermon. It's its own kind of visual sermon. I had the funniest thing happen last night. So when I was kind of polishing it up, kind of putting it all in my brain, I developed a new slide, I put it in there and ran it, a song attached to it. And I went, what the, how did that happen? A song from my YouTube, my iTunes file. And so I unattached it. And I ran it through again, and it reattached it. And I said, here's the funny thing. I got like about 24 hours of music. You know, thousands of songs. It is the perfect song for this sermon. It's like my angel said, "Steve, this song. So you're going to hear the song. And when you hear the song, I want you to get into it. Don't be like a bunch of white Presbyterians that you are." In fact, this whole sermon requires some movement, requires you to kind of get in the groove. And you'll hear it. You're going to see it. So I want you to move. All right, the Big Bang reality, parallel universes and parallel lives. TED Talks. Y'all listen to TED? How many of you, TED? Put your hand up if you know about TED. Woo, got to get more of you listening to TED. TED stands for Technology, Engineering, and Design. Go on to the web, Google TED. That's all you have to do, Google TED. And your world will open up. They have the most bright, brilliant minds in the world. And these guys and gals give anywhere from 5 to 20 minute presentations on the things that they're working on in technology, engineering, and design. Well, I listened to one back in October that just blew my mind. Blew my mind so hard that I started laughing. I was like, oh my gosh, I can't believe it. And what it was, this, it was an astronomer. Astronomer had found not just a black hole, but a blank space in the cosmos. Not a black hole, but a blank space. So he took the Hubble telescope, and he aimed it right at the blank space and took pictures. And what he saw blew him away. Because what he saw is that there was not just a Big Bang. Now, we think about the Big Bang, right? Actually, this TED Talk got me going on this whole sermon series. Let's stop and think about the Big Bang. You know, the Big Bang shapes our concept of reality. The Big Bang shapes our understanding of the cosmos, our understanding of quantum mechanics, our understanding of chaos theory, of string theory. It shapes our understanding of philosophy. It shapes our understanding of engineering. It shapes our understanding of theology. I mean, the Big Bang really drives the world, right? Well, what this astronomer saw was that there's not just one Big Bang, but then actually there was Big Bang, Big Bang, Big Bang, Big Bang, Big Bang, parallel big bangs. He looked through that blank space, and what they think they're seeing is not just one big bang, thousands of them. They saw potentially millions of galaxies that exist outside of what we know to be our cosmos. So parallel universes are no longer something of science fiction or fantasy. They're really beginning to become a part of things that scientists and astronomers are studying. And they're beginning to postulate that even you might already be existing in a parallel universe. That you as a human being might already be over there. And I started thinking about that, and I went, that is so cool that there's another me out there, might be scaring you. But I'm going, that is so awesome. And then I said to myself, but I hope I have at least a good life here as I'm having over there. And you know what I love about that is I started thinking about it, you know, that God, for me, God is the creator of the universe. God is the creator of the cosmos. God is the creator of everything that is. And so if there is a parallel universe, then universes, our God has got to be as big as every single parallel universe that exists. That's why I started thinking back in October of Epiphany, I wanted to do this sermon series called The Big Bang Reality, 13.8 billion years ago, and in your life today, God is still moving. Just as soon as we think we have God figured out, God keeps on moving. That's why for me, the one thing that I want you to walk away with here today, is the concept of endless possibilities. Don't you love that picture? To infinity and beyond, or at least down the street. Do you remember doing that as a kid, you know, flying around? When was the last time you ran down your driveway? Maybe we ought to practice being kids. Because, you know, when you're a kid, you thought you had endless possibilities. But yet, when the older we get, are we thinking our possibilities? No. Parallel universes. If there are parallel universes, you have endless possibilities. And your job is to discover the big bang, the endless possibility. You know, that bang, that whew, the shh. You know, if you were here last week, during that sermon, you heard me talk about the fact that that's what I believe is the sound of the Big Bang, is the bang, whoosh, shh. And so today, this is a participatory sermon. I want you to do that with me. The sound of the Big Bang is bang. That was really, really lame. You barely created Littleton, let alone the cosmos. There was a
bang.
There you go. Now you're catching on. There was the. There was a. So every time you see that slide, I want you to go
bang.
See, I think one of the reasons why God brought you to church today is because some of you need to hear about the bang, the whoosh, and the shh. Because you're thinking that your life is done. You're thinking that there's some type of accident, there's some kind of tragedy, there's some type of calamity that came your way. Maybe it's financial, maybe it has to do with health. And it's like you think, it's over, it's done. And God wants you to come here today, and God wants you to hear, bang, whoosh, shh. There's possibilities. Your life is not done. By the same token, maybe God brought you to church today because you have Velcro on your rear end. And you're like, I ain't changing. I am good right where I am, God. Leave me alone. I like my house. I like my car. I like my partner. I like my kids. I like my job. I like my income. I like everything. Don't. I like my church. I like my friend. Don't. Don't, God. Don't. God said, what are you doing this morning at 9 o'clock? Because you need to hear the bang. Or God brought you to church today because you're going, my life is great. My life is fantastic. My life could not be any better than it is right now. Man, I have got life by the tail. I've got a good groove going on. There is no way my life could be any bigger and better than what it is right now. God said, what are you doing this morning at 9 o'clock? Get to church. It starts at 9:30 because you need to hear the bang. Okay, you were slow. You were slow. You need to hear the bang. You know, for me, this is why I love this story. I will do it again. I didn't know that was there. I wonder how many places else. This keynote has me a little bit scared because something else is going on with it. You know, this is what I love about the story of the fishermen. You know, Jesus calling the fishermen, you know, Peter and Andrew, James and John, they were fishermen, right? It was who they were. I'm looking over here at Dr. Anderson. He's a dentist. It's who he is. Kathy Brown is a technical writer. It's who she is. Matt Spruill is a writer. He's retired. It's who he is. You were teachers. You were whatever. It's who you are. They were fishermen. They were fishermen. They were guys. Their parents did it before they were born. Their parents taught them to be fishermen. It was their identity. It was how they made a living. It was who they were. Maybe they liked it, maybe they didn't like it, but it was their caste, it was their place in society and culture until Jesus came. Which is always a little dicey. People always go, oh, Jesus, come into my life. Because every time Jesus shows up, he's always telling you, you get up, take your pallet, walk. You go raise the dead. You out of the boat, walk on water. You go feed the 5,000. He never tells anybody, stay right where you are. He says, what are the chains that are binding you? It's time to break loose of those chains. It is time to get over it. It is time. There is another universe for your life. You are not. Where you are is good, but there is more. There is another universe for you. There are endless possibilities. So Jesus says to the fishermen, he says, come, follow me. He did not say, stay in the mud. He said, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And do you know what happened? And God attached this song. I could not get this song off this slide. Dixie Chicks. And then when I started thinking about it, I said, you know, that's kind of got the groove. Because, you know, the disciples, they got up. They didn't stay where they were. Man, they got going. And Jesus, you know, they were sending them. He sent them everywhere. He changed their lives. I had to get away. Do you know the words to all this? Come on, Charlie, come here, baby. Come on, come on. Come on, come here. Come on, put your hands together. Charlie, get them to put their hands together. So the disciples, following Jesus, they went from fishermen to fishing foremen. 12 guys who were stuck in the mud ended up changing the world. They happened to believe the direction that Jesus was taking their lives. Live it up when you get the chance. So loosen up the chains so you can dance. What's chaining you? What has you shackled? What do you need to let go of so you can dance? Listen to how the song ends. Awesome. And then that was a God thing. God took over my Macintosh. Oh. You're here today because God wanted you to hear that. You know, God looked at the disciples' lives and saw a blank spot. Parallel universes, unlimited possibilities. They were not just fishermen. They had to figure out how to loosen up their chains so they could dance. We're called to do the same. You're here because you want to follow Jesus. You are here because you have heard Jesus say, "Come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." I mean, that's why you're here. Then you have got to affirm the parallel universe. You have to affirm the ultimate unlimited possibilities for your life. Endless possibilities. Now, I know the problem is that some of you are Velcroed in place. You just don't want to change. You got to know that your life is a blank slate in the hand of God. But I know that some of you feel like you're diagonally parked in a parallel universe. So I have to figure out how to straighten you out. So here are the things I want to propose for you to straighten out. First of all, I like this term that I take from process theology called misplaced concreteness. Misplaced concreteness. In other words, we think our life is concrete. We think our life is solid. We think our life is unmoving and unchanging. And to a certain extent, the older I get, the more that I feel that. I wake up in the morning and go, "Oh man, I feel like a concrete in my joints." But just because your body might be getting more concrete doesn't mean your soul does. Actually, I found that the older you get, the more loose your soul. I got to really watch my words, don't I? Your soul should expand. You know, for me, it's paying attention to what the disciples did. They cast nets. All day long, they were casting nets. You know, do you live like this, or do you live as if you're casting nets? Casting nets. Cast the nets. Oh, come on, that's an old joke. I'm in a groove today. You have to live as if you know Ephesians 3:20. By looking at this picture, what do you think Ephesians 3:20 says? Person at the 8 o'clock said, "Catch and release." Another person said, "Five more of these and I can feed the 5,000. This is what Ephesians 3:20 says. God is able to do immeasurably more than what we can ask or imagine. God, I want to catch a fish. Ask. Jesus said, ask. Seek. Knock. It is your Father's good pleasure to give to you. You know, I spend a lot of time in my life asking God to show me what I'm supposed to do. Show me what I'm supposed to say. Show me where I'm supposed to go. God, ask, I ask God, tell me who I need to go talk to. Fill my ideas, fill my brain with ideas, God. Ask. And it's not that God is some kind of divine vending machine. I mean, but it's like when we start asking, what it does is it starts turning the flywheel of our imagination. Ask and imagine. Endless possibilities. Right now, you know what? I can feel a juice moving through you. I can feel that God is spinning through some of you right now, and you are hearing God say, do you remember when I talked with you a few months ago about the ability of you to go do? Well, it's there. Do you imagine? Do you visualize? Do you know, I never come and stand in front of a group of people. I never come on Sunday morning until I have visualized the entire sermon. I don't memorize, I visualize. I visualize, and then my imagination takes over. I imagine having conversations with you. I imagine having conversations with people outside of the world. I have visions and ideas about things that I want to talk about. I hear a TED Talks. I see a piece of art. I listen to a piece of music, and suddenly I allow my imagination to go, are you imagining? Are you imagining a parallel you, an ultimate you? Are you imagining the great things that God wants to do with you in your life? Are you imagining? Are you asking God to do that? Or you're like that Velcro guy. Well, then you know what you need to do? When you ask and imagine, you need to hear what the author of Ephesians says. Immeasurably more. Immeasurably more. Millions of galaxies. Immeasurably more. I tell you, just an old personal story. I almost decided not to, but decided I would do it. Because I want you to know that it's a huge part of my life. Ask and imagine. So I've been told for many, many months, almost a couple years, that I need to start asking to speak to a broader crowd. And that's why I said, well, let's do the camera. Let's, you know, ask, and imagine. I was told, imagine. So I would picture myself speaking to thousands of people, And so when a phone call came, you know, a few weeks ago, we want you to do a service at a stadium where there will be about 6,000 people. Is that going to bother you, that type of crowd? No, I'm not bothered by that at all. So we got there, and all of a sudden the cameras are being set up. Oh, by the way, it's going to be picked up by every station, every cable station, and it's going to be all over the United States. It's going to be picked up by the New York Times, the LA Times, the Washington Post. Is that going to bother you? And I thought, you're so funny. Immeasurably more than what you can ask or imagine. We got this little like view of our lives. We have this little view of our children's lives. And God says, ask, imagine immeasurably more. You know what I love about the disciples? You know what they did? They immediately left. They immediately dropped their nets. You notice that they didn't say, Jesus, is there a pension plan? Will I have a 401k? Will there be insurance with this program? You, Jesus, had those kind of people in his ministry, and you know what he told them? Let the dead go bury their own dead. I'm going this way. You either come with me now or you don't come. It's kind of a harsh part of the master. But it's like with your life. The door opens. The window opens. The Velcro. Or immediately. Casting the nets. Going. You know, what's really interesting is that there's another minister from the Presbytery of Denver who's having trouble getting his church off the ground. And he came to visit us and look at our staff and wonder how we're doing things. And it was really cool to talk about what we're doing at Columbine United Church so we could figure out what's going on with his church. And so then in the middle of the conversation, he said, "Well, Steve, so what is your vision for Columbine United Church? To change the world." So, I mean, really, I mean, seriously, like, what is your vision for Columbine United Church? To change the world. Justin, what is the vision for Columbine United Church? Kind of sounds kind of audacious, doesn't it? Kind of arrogant. And for me, it doesn't feel audacious, doesn't feel arrogant when there are millions of galaxies. There are millions of galaxies, and changing our world? How was that so hard? How was that so hard? You know, for me, it's like we feed 30,000. You know what I hear God telling us? End hunger. That's why Barb's statistics here in the beginning of the worship service, they kind of offended me. It made me angry. Lord, have mercy. There's 100,000 children in Colorado that are living under the poverty line. And that's why, you know, I've set this big, hairy, audacious goal for me for this coming year is for Columbine United Church to feed 30,000 and end hunger. Started a group called Forks and Faith. You're going to be hearing more about this. But, you know, for me, you know, Matt says to me throughout the year, he says, "Steve, you got to get the people to keep on bringing in the food because we're not hitting our goals for feeding 30,000. Feeding 30,000 people should be like this. We live in an abundant land. You have abundant gifts. You have immeasurably more at your fingertips. And sometimes it's not there because we're not asking, we're not imagining the endless possibilities." What are you chained to? What do you need to let go of so you can hear the get this song off this slide. Let's pray. God, I feel your presence moving in such a powerful way. Like a hand spinning. Like a potter's wheel spinning, like a galaxy spinning. You sent your Son to unchain us, to unshackle us. You sent your Son so that we might open up our hearts and minds to seeing how you are so with us, that you so empower us. And so, God, I ask that you pump us up. I ask that you help us get excited. I ask that you help us to leave here today knowing that we can change our lives, change our families, change our neighborhoods, change the world. Oh, God, you need lights of hope that will shine in the dark. I pray, oh God, that you give us the courage to be that light and that hope. Your Son repeatedly sent people. He taught them to pray. He sent them out. And so, oh God, help us to feel that presence of sending as you pour upon us your Spirit as we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.